Good afternoon. Welcome to today's APS virtual program, a conversation with Lucas Rappel on his new book, Assembling the Dinosaur, Fossil Hunters, Tycoons, and the Making of a Spectacle. I'm glad that so many of you were able to join us today. For those of you joining us for the first time, the American Philosophical Society was founded by Benjamin Franklin in 1743. The society is a catalyst for the discovery of new knowledge. Election to membership honors those who have made exceptionally significant contributions to science, the arts and humanities, and public life. The Society promotes research by providing over $1 million in research grants a year, grants that primarily go to younger scholars who need the support the most. Our library and museum collections and research centers serve scholars and visitors from across the globe. Our facilities are now physically closed, but we remain committed to serving our mission to promoting useful knowledge through virtual programming, such as today's conversation. I hope you will check out our website, amphilsoc.org, to learn more about what we do and for news of forthcoming events. We are using Zoom webinar today, so no worries. You have all been muted. You won't accidentally interrupt the conversation. If you have a question, and we do hope you do, we're gonna use the last 20 minutes or so of the program for Q&A. I'd ask you to use the Q&A button at the center bottom of your navigation bar. It should be right there in the center. Ask your questions there, and when we get to the Q&A time, we will pose them to our speakers. With that, it is my great pleasure to introduce Robert McCracken Peck, Senior Fellow of the Academy of Natural Sciences of Drexel University, and a member of the APS Committee on Library and Museum, who will explain today's program and introduce our speakers. Thank you for being here.
Hello, everyone. Sorry for the delay there. I'm still working on the technology around me. So glad that you could be with us for this conversation. We're going to have, a fun hour ahead. We'll speak for maybe 20 minutes or so and then open to Q&A from you. I wanted to put it into kind of a context here, a Philadelphia context, because the whole field of paleontology, the study of dinosaurs and so on, began in the United States, here in Philadelphia, mostly at the Academy of Natural Sciences. But it sort of indirectly had a start in London. And I'm showing here a slide of the Crystal Palace, the Sydenham site of the Crystal Palace. The Crystal Palace exhibition, as you know, the international show in London began in 1851. But in 1853, they decided to move it to another site in southern London. And a young artist named Benjamin Waterhouse Hawkins was hired to create some interesting sculptures in the park. And you can see them here in the foreground. These were the first life-size depictions of dinosaurs. And they were absolutely enormous, as you can see by the scale of the people wandering around them. In the next slide, I have a portrait of Benjamin Waterhouse Hawkins as he looked about the time he was making these sculptures. He was a talented guy who had a number of different skills. He had served as an illustrator for Charles Darwin after the Voyage of the Beagle. He helped to illustrate the fish, reptiles, and amphibians. He worked with Thomas Henry Huxley and really all the giants in the field of natural history in the early part of the 19th century. But he was also a very talented sculptor. And so he was hired to Richard Owen, who was sort of the scientific advisor to the Crystal Palace installation, hired Hawkins to create these sculptures. And they used as much information as they had available at the time. Some fossil evidence had begun to surface. Interesting things had been unearthed in various places. And so with Richard Owen's help, Hawkins reconstructed what he thought these creatures might have looked like. In the next slide, you'll see his studio on the Crystal Palace grounds. Again, that will give you a sense of scale. He had a very famous dinner party on New Year's Eve of 1853-54, in which he invited his guests to come and sit inside the mold of the iguanodon, which is the big featured creature here in the center of this image. It got a lot of press for him. I think it must have been a memorable occasion for everyone involved. a few years later, he was invited to come to New York, or he chose, it's not quite clear whether he was actively invited or he just chose to come to do a lecture circuit. And I think we have another slide here of Joseph Leidy was a paleontologist based at the Academy of Natural Sciences with whom he'd been corresponding and who would help him with a project he was invited to take on by the commissioners of Central Park. In the next slide, you'll see, I guess we've skipped over the slide of the design he did for the museum in New York. Essentially, they wanted to create a paleo, what they called a Paleozoic museum in the city of New York that would be inspired by the Crystal Palace exhibition. The problem was that in 1868, when he was invited to come and do this, there was no American Museum of Natural History yet. There was no paleontology in New York. And so Hawkins had to come to Philadelphia because that was the center of scientific research. The Academy of Natural Sciences had been in existence since 1812 and had been working on paleontological subjects from shortly after that founding period. And Joseph Leidy, whose picture you saw in a moment, had, with a member of the American Philosophical Society named Folk, he had described a new species of dinosaur, Hadrosaurus folci, which was Folk's bulky lizard. Folk had found these remains of a dinosaur in Haddonfield, New Jersey, in kind of a marl pit, and had taken a whole summer to excavate these with the help of Leidy and with others from the Academy. Hawkins was very eager to see these bones and help and sought help from Leidy in how to reconstruct them. And so at the Academy, he took what bones had been unearthed, created plaster of Paris bones casts to replicate the missing ones, and created this creature that you see on the left-hand side of your screen. Leidy decided that because of the anatomy of the dinosaur, short front legs, long back legs, that it probably stood up on its back legs like a kangaroo. And it was that way that Hawkins mounted it, creating a metal armature and then connecting, dangling the bones from it. We now know that that's not exactly the way that this creature stood, but it was the best knowledge of the time. And when this cast was presented to the Academy of Natural Sciences by Hawkins as a thank you for allowing him to come and make the cast here in Philadelphia, it caused a huge sensation. And over 100,000 people came to see it at the museum in just the first year. And that was during a period when it was only open two afternoons a week, and it was closed for most of the summer. So you can imagine 100,000 people in Philadelphia in 1869. Coming to a museum to see this, it was unprecedented. It was the first articulated dinosaur ever seen in any museum in the world, and it became kind of the standard by which dinosaurs would be displayed and all kinds of other creatures would be displayed going forward from that time. Hawkins was in great demand after that. He was working in New York to prepare this paleontological, or as they called it, Paleozoic museum. But he left his cast molds in Philadelphia, fortunately. So he was able to make more of these later. And the reason I say he left it here, fortunately, is because he had a terrible tragedy. After working for 3 years on assembling dinosaurs to put in this great museum that was going to be in Central Park, Boss Tweed, who was the political operator, should we call him, in New York at the time, got angry that he was not getting enough of the kickbacks he expected from government projects. He saw that Hawkins was being paid a handsome salary, that he had a studio in Central Park, that he was creating these dinosaurs and was going to make a museum. And Tweed decided he hadn't been properly recompensed for this and was going to make sure it didn't happen. So in March of 1871, he sent a bunch of thugs into Hawkins' studio and they smashed everything up, destroyed the Hadrosaurus falci, destroyed the other things that Hawkins had been working so hard on, and took them all out, threw them in the lake, and they generally disappeared. Needless to say, Hawkins was devastated by this, and the whole project came grinding to a halt. Fortunately, he had built enough of a reputation here in America that he was hired to give lectures. Princeton University hired him to create some oil paintings of prehistoric life. He was actually given an honorary degree by Princeton. And he stayed here for a number of years, went back to London, then returned to America to create a couple more casts of the Hadrosaurus falci, including one for the Centennial Exposition in Philadelphia in 1876. But he made one for the Smithsonian, one ended up in the Field Museum, and so on. So this creature that had been unearthed in New Jersey ended up sort of spread all around the world. That, I think, helps you to see the context for our talk today. I wanted to introduce our distinguished speaker, Lucas Rupel, who is the David and Michelle Ebersman Assistant Professor of History at Brown University, where he teaches the history of science, the history of capitalism, and is the author, as you've heard in the introduction, of a wonderful book, Assembling the Dinosaur, Fossil Hunters, Tycoons, and the Making of Spectacle, published by Harvard University Press in 2019. In conversation with him will be Adrian Link, who's the head of scholarly programs here at the American Philosophical Society. She has her PhD from Johns Hopkins University on 20th century American anthropology. And so without further ado, let's turn the computers over to Lucas and Adriana, and they can take the conversation from here.
Great. Thank you so much, Kyle, and so much to Bob Peck for introducing today's program. Lucas and I are really excited to be here today to talk about the history of paleontology with all of you. And you know, I think, Bob, you did a great favor to us by introducing the context for today's event. But you know, I think, as Lucas does so well in this really wonderful book that he wrote, is to show that you know, the real history of paleontology, at least in the United States, didn't start in Philadelphia, didn't start on the East Coast, but really took off in the American West. So, you know, Lucas, maybe you can give us a context of what the history of vertebrate paleontology looked like on the other side of the country. How did the dinosaur fossils that we know and love that ended up in places like the Academy of Natural Sciences, how did they get here? How did they get to Philadelphia and to the East Coast?
Sure, I'm happy to. Thanks, Adriana, and thanks, Robert, for the introduction. Should I share my screen? How should we do this?
Yeah, let's get your screen up.
Okay, let me see if I can figure out how to do it. I think this is right. Okay, so if you don't mind, I actually wanted to start quickly across the pond. So this is just a very brief kind of look at how dinosaurs were discovered to begin with in the UK. One thing that's really interesting about the story is that one of the greatest early fossilists, as they were known, fossil collectors, people who collected fossils for a living, was a woman named Mary Anning, who grew up in a seaside resort in southwestern England called Lyme Regis. And Lyme Regis is a beautiful place where the cliffs are exposed to the ocean. And so, especially in the wintertime when there's great storms in the English Channel, the erosion that's created by kind of crashing waves against the cliffs exposes new fossils to light. And that's still the case today. There's a lot of fossil collecting that still happens on the southern coast of, southwestern coast of England. And Mary Anning discovered a huge number of really spectacular specimens, which she sold to British naturalists, including specimens like the ichthyosaur, which is a kind of prehistoric marine reptile that you can see pictured here next to Mary Anning, as well as the plesiosaur, another sort of marine reptile. So the kind of early history of paleontology in England focused on these marine reptiles. but it's in the kind of beginning of the 19th century. And it was largely driven by independent fossil hunters, like Mary Anning, who sold their wares, their collections, to naturalists who are interested in these objects as objects of knowledge. Dinosaurs were discovered a couple of decades later in the 1820s and 30s by two British naturalists named Gideon Mantell and William Buckland, who found the first dinosaur fossils to be described as such in the United Kingdom. They were given the name dinosaur by Richard Owen, another British naturalist, in I think 1842. And then were sculpted for popular acclaim in the 1850s by Benjamin Waterhouse Hawkins, which you just heard Robert Peck talk about. One thing quickly to mention about the Crystal Palace dinosaurs is these are two photographs that I took of the Crystal Palace dinosaurs myself when I made a kind of pilgrimage to Sydenham a few years ago. So if you're interested in this history and you're interested in traveling, then if you ever find yourself in London, I would really encourage you to go to Sydenham because you can see these sculptures still. Here's a lithograph showing the Paleozoic Museum that Robert Peck talked about. So this is a rendering that I believe Benjamin Waterhouse Hawkins himself made of the kind of proposed design for the New York Paleozoic, the ill-fated Paleozoic Museum that was destroyed by the Tweed Ring. But as Adriana mentioned, so the earliest English dinosaurs, the earliest American dinosaurs, the first dinosaur discovered in the United States was Hadrosaurus, which was found by William Parker Folk, this avocational naturalist, the kind of amateur naturalist. And I think he was a lawyer in Haddonfield, New Jersey, and then described by Joseph Leidy, a member of the Philadelphia Academy of Natural Sciences. But really the history of paleontology in the United States took off in a really big way a couple of decades later, really one decade later in the 1870s, with the discovery of dinosaurs in the American West. So creatures like these that you're probably quite familiar with, many of you I suspect probably even more familiar than Hadrosaurus. So creatures like Brontosaurus, Stegosaurus, Allosaurus is a close relative of T-Rex. All of these were found in the late 1870s and subsequently. So kind of 1880s, 1890s is sort of the, it's often called the Jurassic dinosaur rush. So a kind of gold rush for dinosaur bones in the American West. And like the earliest British fossils, these two were found not so much by trained naturalists, not by people with, you know, PhDs in natural history or anything like that, but rather by independent fossil hunters, in particular William Harlow Reed, who you can see pictured in the center here, who discovered a really productive dinosaur quarry in southern Wyoming called Como Bluff in 1877. And like Mary Anning, sold their dinosaur bones to the highest bidder. So in Reed's case, he sold his dinosaurs to a paleontologist, I think I have a photograph of him, yeah, paleontologist named Othniel Charles Marsh, who was a professor at Yale University. The other really important paleontologist at this time, in addition to Marsh and Leidy, was Edward Drinker Cope, who was also affiliated with the Academy of Natural Sciences in Philadelphia, and also affiliated with the University of Pennsylvania. But both Marsh and Cope acquired most of their early dinosaur discoveries by purchasing them from independent fossil collectors who were located in the American West, people like William Harlow Reed, many of whom were mineral prospectors. Reed was also employed by the Union Pacific Railroad. So not people who primarily had a kind of intellectual or scholarly interest in dinosaurs, but rather more of a kind of financial interest in these objects.
Great, and one of the points I really love that you make in your book too is kind of talking about how there's this disconnect between the expertise that exists on the East Coast of the United States, people like Marsh and Cope, who are in Yale and in Philadelphia, and the people out west who are digging for other minerals, other kinds of natural resources. Can you talk about how this idea of supply and demand, what that network kind of looks like and how it informs your arguments about the way that capitalism informed the sort of promotion of paleontology as its own scientific discipline?
Yeah, sure, I'd love to. So just to go back to this slide. So here we have, so these are three independent fossil hunters that I've put on this slide because each of them independently discovered a dinosaur quarry in the same year, in the year 1877, which is kind of a remarkable coincidence in the history of paleontology that really it's in this one year that all these different dinosaur bones were found in the American West. And like I said, none of them were primarily interested in these. They were interested in natural history, but I would say their primary interest was more financial. So one of them was William Harlow Reed, who I've already mentioned. Another one was Orimel Lucas. He was a kind of primary school teacher in I believe in Canyon City, Colorado. And then there was also Arthur Lakes, who was a clergyman. Actually, he was of the three the most well-educated. He had a degree from Oxford University, but became a mining engineer in Morrison, Colorado. He actually worked for the Colorado School of Mines most of his life. So all three of these were kind of frontier prospectors, sort of entrepreneurs, people who were hoping to make money, doing various kinds of activities in the American West. And it's, I wouldn't quite go so far as to say they had no expertise. They had a great deal of expertise about life on the frontier, about fossil hunting. They especially had expertise about the location of dinosaur bones. But generally what they did not have so much of, in particular Reed and Lucas, is a great deal of kind of specialized knowledge about natural history. So especially kind of taxonomic knowledge. For example, when William Harlow Reed found his dinosaur quarry in Como Bluff in Wyoming, he wrote to Marsh to announce the discovery and ask if Marsh might be interested in purchasing it. And he speculated that the bones might be those of what he called a megatherium, which is a kind of extinct mammal, very famous extinct mammal at the time. And so he didn't recognize the bones to be those of a dinosaur. This is just a painting that was made, I think by Arthur Lakes, of William Harlow Reed. So here you can see Reed in the foreground, if you can see that. And that's Como Bluff behind him. So these kind of striated, very characteristic sort of geological layers as one can find in the American West. And here you can see the Union Pacific Railroad, which is an important part of the story. So you might wonder why 1877, right? Why is it in the late 19th century that all these dinosaurs start to be found out west? And a big part of the reason is the completion of a transcontinental railroad, which both opened the space up for exploration and colonization, I would say, by white settlers from the kind of east coast of the United States, but also connected this region to population centers on the east and in the Midwest, places like Chicago, Pittsburgh, Philadelphia, New York, and so on and so forth. So one thing that I became quite interested in is the kind of fairly acrimonious negotiation tactics between these naturalists, people like Othniel Charles Marsh and Edward Drinker Cope, versus mineral prospectors and kind of independent fossil hunters, people like William Harlow Reed. And because each of them had access to different kinds of knowledge, different kinds of information, a lot of what the kind of, there was a long and drawn out kind of bargaining session that usually followed these discoveries, where someone like Reed would write letters to Marsh and say, oh, I've made this great discovery, are you interested in perhaps purchasing them? And Marsh would write back and say, like, well, I don't know, maybe, what did you find? And it's basically this kind of really interesting and intricate dance between the two parties, where both is trying to kind of extract valuable information out of the other, information about the quality, location, and most importantly, the value of these discoveries. Because neither party really, because they were separated by such immense distances, and because they had access to different kinds of knowledge, on the one hand, you had people like Marsh who knew a lot about taxonomy and natural history. On the other hand, you had someone like Reed who actually was in close physical proximity to these bones and so knew what they looked like, different kinds of knowledge. And so therefore they were trying to sort of leverage their access to different kinds of information to try to get the most money out of the deal possible. In the end, Marsh and Cope usually ended up getting the better end of the bargain because they had access to financial resources. So Reed, for example, was quite impoverished for most of his life. And so he just didn't have much leverage. But yeah, there was this very kind of characteristic sort of, it's in some ways kind of a sort of almost kind of stereotypical kind of cliched story of the Wild West, right? Sort of you have these mining camps in the American West, people prospecting for gold and silver and other kind of mineral resources. And the sorts of practices, this kind of fairly shifty, somewhat shady kind of economic dealings in which they engaged, you see very similar kinds of dynamics in the market for vertebrate fossils, which I think really shaped the sort of scientific practices in paleontology in the late 19th century in the United States.
Great. Well, there was another kind of economics at play too with back on the East Coast with the emergence of these brand new philanthropic museums. So you talk a lot in the book about kind of how the rise of institutions like the Carnegie Museum in Pittsburgh and the Museum of Natural History in New York, how these institutions emerged as products of kind of these big philanthropic shifts that were happening in the economy. Can you talk about kind of the some of the problems with getting specimens from West to the East Coast, some of the kind of strategies of management that were employed. And, you know, these dig sites that you've mentioned, it's not like you go out there and you just find a dinosaur intact. Like, what were people kind of dealing with as they were moving things from the West and putting them on display in the East?
Yeah, great. You're definitely right that there's a lot of kind of problems of access to scarce information, including scarce information about what these creatures might have looked like. So just to give you a sense, let's go back quickly. These are the Crystal Palace dinosaurs. These are iguanodons. So these are actually quite close relatives of Hadrosaurus, which you saw earlier. I imagine this is very different than how most people watching this webinar imagine dinosaurs today. Here's a rendering. This is a lithograph produced by Edward Drinker Cope, one of these two naturalists affiliated with the Philadelphia Academy of Natural Sciences. This is actually Hadrosaurus here in the foreground. You can see that very characteristic kangaroo-like pose, right, with the strong, well, muscular hind legs and then the strong tail used as a sort of tripod for support, and then other sorts of prehistoric creatures. Again, looking very, like, so there's a lot that's not known about these creatures. Here's Brontosaurus. These are restorations, renderings made by Marsh, the Yale paleontologist, Brontosaurus and Stegosaurus. Really strange alien creatures, unlike anything that people were familiar with in the late 19th century United States, of course. Kind of extant creatures like you might be used to finding walking around, you know, in a city or in the countryside or something like that. So there's a lot of kind of speculation involved in reconstructing these animals. We can get back to that point in a minute. But here's just one more slide I wanted to show to give you a sense of the geography, the immense amounts of distance that separated learned naturalists, people like Joseph Leidy, Edward Drinker Cope, Otniel Charles Marsh, people like that, learned naturalists affiliated with institutions of learning like the Philadelphia Academy, from how, the great distance that separated them from fossil hunters, independent fossil hunters in the American West. So these are the three quarries that I mentioned that were simultaneously discovered in 1877 in southern Wyoming and Colorado. And here's showing you the location of Yale University. This is Philadelphia, and this is Haddonfield, the discovery site for Hadrosaurus. So, you know, a really considerable amount of space that separated these two. And it was, as I mentioned, only once there was a transcontinental railroad that really opened up this interior space for colonization, but also for the extraction of natural resources and knowledge, that some of that space could be traversed through new technological breakthroughs like the transcontinental railroad. A lot of the people who went out west did so in search of mineral wealth, which kind of helped to shape this extractive economy, but also, as I mentioned, the sort of setting of dinosaur paleontology. So Adriana, you asked about the kind of philanthropic museums, the setting in which a lot of this, the kind of destination for a lot of these bones. So Robert Peck told us about the Philadelphia Academy, which had a museum in Philadelphia, and as well as the Paleozoic Museum, which of course was never completed. Right around the time that William Boss Tweed, this New York machine politician from the New York Democratic Party, destroyed the Paleozoic Museum and the sculptures that Benjamin Waterhouse Hawkins was working on, right around the same time, a group of New York socialites and kind of members of the New York wealthy elite, industrial financial capitalists from Manhattan, were busy planning for the creation of a new museum, which would become the American Museum of Natural History. And a lot of the dinosaur bones that were initially collected by Edward Drinker Cope and Otniel Charles Marsh went not just to universities and scientific societies, but increasingly, especially around the turn of the 20th century, started to be displayed in spectacular ways in these new museums. The American Museum of Natural History on the Upper West Side of New York being a particularly good example. So here's just a page showing you this I think is the first annual report for the New York Natural History Museum. And it shows you the names of the trustees. So these are the kind of founding trustees of the institution. And I've just highlighted some of the more famous names on this list. So people like Theodore Roosevelt, the future president of the United States, the father of the future president of the United States.
Can you zoom in on this list just for a second? Because I think it might be a little hard for folks to see.
Let's see. Is that
great? Better? Yep, that looks better.
Sure. So Theodore Roosevelt, famous industrial capitalist in the late 19th century, as I said, also kind of the father of a political dynasty, you might say. J.P. Morgan, another kind of prominent name on this list and some others that you might recognize too. So an interesting question is, well, what were these financial and industrial capitalists doing? Why did they become so interested in the science of natural history? And why did they become such avid philanthropists? And in my book, I try to make an argument that there's really a whole bunch of different, it's kind of a fascinating story about what the motivations for this really boom in philanthropy that took place in the United States in the very late 19th century, turn of the 20th century, how we can understand this, the motivations for this boom in philanthropy. And one kind of argument I make is that a lot of these people, especially industrial capitalists, people like Theodore Roosevelt Sr., Andrew Carnegie is another great example of this, hailed from relatively humble or often quite artisanal kind of backgrounds. These were not often people who were born into a great deal of wealth and social distinction. And so in order for them to kind of forge an identity for themselves as members of this upwardly mobile social elite, in order for them to kind of forge a new class identity for themselves, they had to find some way of kind of performing their elite social status, some way of kind of signaling their social status to themselves and each other. And they did that in all sorts of ways. One of them is, here's just an example of this. This is a slide showing you an opulent mansion built, I think, by the Vanderbilts in Newport, Rhode Island, called the Breakers in the late 19th century. So they surrounded themselves with kind of signals of opulence and wealth. And natural history collections were just one example of that. They also collected art. They would go to fancy restaurants and kind of show off their appreciation of fine dining. They would enjoy kind of difficult symphonic music and that kind of thing. So they would engage in all sorts of activities that were traditionally associated with the social and cultural elite. At the same time, though, the late 19th century was a period not just of tremendous economic growth, a lot of which was fueled by this extractive economy in the American West that I talked about a few minutes ago. It was also a great period of growing social inequality in many ways, kind of similar to the period that we're currently living in now, in that sense that it was a period of huge social inequality and therefore a great deal of social unrest. So there was a kind of not just a moment that saw the creation of an elite social class in the United States, but also a self-conscious and often quite rebellious and rambunctious working class. And there was a real kind of sense of panic among the social and cultural financial elite that a revolutionary uprising might be in the air, that some of the working people who saw their wages stagnate, at times even decline during the late 19th century, who really faced kind of brutal working conditions, very low wages, kind of very poor sanitation, living conditions, and so on and so forth, were forming labor unions, were kind of engaging in strikes and these sorts of activities, that they might engage in revolutionary activities that could bring the American industrial economy to its knees. So in these social elites, in addition to celebrating their wealth by building these opulent mansions like the Breakers, they also increasingly started to try to find ways to sort of celebrate not just their wealth, but also their civic liberality, their republican virtues. And that philanthropy was kind of the best way to do that. So not just collecting art and hoarding it in their own mansions, but creating art museums, places like the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York City and many others. I believe the Freer Gallery in Philadelphia is part of this kind of story as well. Institutions like this all over the United States to open those art collections and make them accessible to the general public as a way of trying to sort of educate and uplift, and you might even say kind of instill bourgeois, traditionally kind of bourgeois values and virtues among working class audiences. And natural history was seen as a particularly good way of doing that. And so the New York Museum of Natural History and others like the Carnegie Museum in Pittsburgh or the Field Museum in Chicago emerged around the sort of late 19th, early 20th century with huge amounts of funding for these, from these financial elites to engage in not to produce natural history exhibits that would be, that would appeal to popular tastes. And of course, what sorts of natural history specimens are more appealing than any other natural history specimens, right? Dinosaurs, right? So Robert Peck told us about when the Philadelphia Academy opened its Hadrosaurus exhibit in the late 1860s, I believe. He said 100,000 people came to see the new exhibit within the space of just a couple of years. So kind of filling up the exhibition hall of the Philadelphia Academy. So there's a kind of track record of dinosaurs being particularly popular among all sorts of social classes. And so these new museums, these new and really well-funded museums of natural history, like the one in New York, very quickly became really interested in setting up very well-funded departments of vertebrate paleontology, the purpose of which was both to kind of become, to cement the status of the United States as a world leader in this new science, this new and exciting science of paleontology, many of the specimens for which were being discovered in the American West, but also to draw large audiences into the exhibition halls of these museums so as to be able to make the argument that American capitalism wasn't just benefiting the wealthy few, right, but through these kind of philanthropic bequests could be made to work for the good of all in society. Look at these great exhibits that we can produce, giving you the kind of things that you want to see, but also kind of educating you, uplifting you, and so on and so forth in these august temples of science.
Great. I think we have a couple more minutes for me to ask questions, but I will encourage people who are watching at home, if you have a question, to please submit it through the Q&A feature, and we'll turn to those in a couple of minutes. I want to continue with this thread about sort of social uplift and progress and kind of get into maybe the early 20th century when people, as you've mentioned, anxiety, and one of the really great points that you make in this book is about how dinosaurs in some ways, we're both kind of an exemplar of American wealth and progress, but also a warning about what can happen in the pursuit of progress. So can you maybe talk about how those ideas intersect with other kind of social and cultural, zeitgeists that were happening in the early 20th century?
Yeah, absolutely. I'd love to. I would say the best specimen or the best dinosaur with which to do that is Tyrannosaurus rex. So T-Rex was discovered a little bit later than some of the dinosaurs we've been talking about. I think the first T-Rex was discovered in 1902, I believe, by a paleontologist named Barnum Brown, who was named after P.T. Barnum. It's kind of interesting. Another kind of interesting coincidence of history. Anyway, Barnum Brown found T-Rex in, I believe, 1902 in, I think it was Montana in the American West. Found a couple of specimens. And one thing that is especially interesting about T-Rex that many other historians, not just myself, have noted about T-Rex is that perhaps more so than any other creature from prehistory, T-Rex sort of embodied this idea of dinosaurs as having been not just especially large, but also especially fearsome, right? That T-Rex was this ferocious predator. Even its name, Tyrannosaurus rex, right, sort of invokes this idea of a kind of tyrant of the prehistoric. And this kind of narrative very quickly took hold in the late 19th century that dinosaurs were particularly big, particularly violent, particularly fearsome, but also not particularly intelligent. So kind of lumbering, stupid behemoth who could really kind of wreak havoc on the world in which they lived. So from the moment that T-Rex was discovered, this is a kind of feature of this specimen that was played up to great effect. Here's just a newspaper article. I think this is a quote from the New York Times by Barnum Brown, where he says that T-Rex was, quote, so formidable a fighting machine that he easily preyed upon herbivorous neighbors twice his own size, making this newly discovered monster the absolute warlord of the earth in his day, right? So really kind of evocative, I would say socially charged language to describe prehistoric creatures that lived long before any human being had ever evolved. The headline for the article is "The Prize Fighter of Antiquity Discovered and Restored," right? And you can see that here as well in the kind of exhibit. This is actually an exhibit that was never completed, but a model for a proposed exhibit of two T-Rex specimens fighting over some prey. So here you can see two specimens fighting over, I think this is a section of Brontosaurus, kind of hind limbs and vertebra. And so the scene is meant to kind of evoke this idea of the past, the deep past, as a time of great struggle, right? As kind of nature red in tooth and claw. And this is a theme that you can see all over the place, right? So here's just, I'll give you a couple more examples. This is Allosaurus predating upon a section of Brontosaurus tail. This is a painting commissioned by J.P. Morgan from the artist Charles Knight, a kind of successor to Benjamin Waterhouse Hawking's. Showing two early American dinosaurs, early discoveries from the 19th century, Dryptosaurus. At the time it was called Elaps equilinguis, again, engaged in a kind of fight to the death. So you might think, and many historians have thought that, the story is obvious, right? That dinosaurs served as a way of kind of cementing the narrative of social Darwinism, right? So there's exhibits that are like these, right? This is a painting commissioned by J.P. Morgan, kind of financial industrial capitalists, commissioned these exhibitions and these artworks to celebrate the power of competition in nature and political economy, right? The competition is good for capitalism. We want competitive markets. We want kind of ruthless competition in the social world. Inequality is the outcome of this competition. It's not a bad thing. It's actually just a natural thing. It's just a fact of nature. In fact, it's so natural that it long predates the evolution of human society, even in prehistory, even during the age of dinosaurs. the world was a ruthlessly competitive place. So all you socialists out there who are trying to kind of spark a revolution, you're not going to get anywhere because you're basically fighting against nature. So that's the kind of way that people have usually interpreted these sorts of exhibits. And in my book, I try to make a slightly different argument. And the main reason for that is that there's a huge problem with this interpretation, which is dinosaurs, of course, went extinct. So if dinosaurs are supposed to be a kind of symbol for the kind of virtues of competitive capitalism, they're not a very good choice because they didn't last very long, right? Kind of dinosaurs went extinct. And if you look at the way that they're exhibited in museums, they're always inserted into these kind of teleological narratives of evolutionary progress, where the dinosaur hall is always followed by a hall of mammals and a hall of the age of man, right? So there's this very kind of narrative that's being given to museum visitors that the extinction of dinosaurs opened up the ecological space for evolutionary progress. And that evolutionary progress is manifested in the evolution of increased intelligence and indeed increased cooperation in nature. So if you compare the way dinosaurs are exhibited to the way early mammals and especially hominids are exhibited, mammals are always shown kind of not competing with one another, not fighting with one another, but rather cooperating with one another. And of course, this is the kind of narrative that people like J.P. Morgan wanted to spread about the history of capitalism too. The late 19th, early 20th century was not a time of particularly competitive capitalism. In fact, it was quite the opposite, that this is a time of corporate consolidation of monopoly capitalism. And so the way that capitalists like J.P. Morgan or Andrew Carnegie, these avid philanthropists, the way that they wanted museum visitors to understand the history of capitalism is not as a history of kind of progress through competition, but rather a history of progress in which competition is replaced by management. Right, in which a kind of more rational political economy emerged so that the kind of competitive marketplace that was described by 18th century political economists, people like Adam Smith, was an agrarian economy, but the industrial economy had to be managed differently. It should not be competitive, but rather it should be more cooperative. And the claim was that these monopolistic corporations like J.P. Morgan's investment bank or Andrew Rockefeller's Standard Oil or Carnegie Steel or corporations like this, in fact, that they were kind of cooperative enterprises that could more efficiently and more rationally manage the political economy from the top down, just as intelligent hominids could kind of manage their world to greater effect and to better effect than these primitive, ruthlessly competitive dinosaurs could. It's just a couple of examples of that. So here's just to end with this. So just to compare quickly, this is a very famous painting by Charles Knight from the Field Museum of Natural History in Chicago, showing a kind of epic standoff of two titans of the prehistoric, right? Triceratops fighting against Tyrannosaurus Rex, and showing you that dinosaurs, when they're shown in these museum exhibits and paintings and restorations of other kinds, they're usually shown in isolation. When they're interacting with one another, those interactions are almost always competitive, usually revolving around acts of predation, so acts of extreme violence. Here, contrast that with woolly mammoths, right? So you have a bunch of mammoths, they seem to be sort of half encircling one of their young, sort of working in concert with one another to protect one of their offspring. Here's another example. This is a paleontological exhibit of the Megatherium. This is this ground sloth that I mentioned. William Harlow Reed, when he discovered his quarry in Wyoming, thought he had found a Megatherium quarry. In fact, they were dinosaurs. Anyway, Megatherium were these mammals that evolved slightly later after the extinction of dinosaurs, cooperating with one another to procure a common food source, right? So you have one individual in the background pushing down this tree so that they can reach the succulent leaves in the crown of the tree. You have another individual in the front sort of digging up the roots to make it easier for the one in the back to push down the tree. You have a third individual ready to rear up on its hind legs to kind of help and help push down the tree, and a fourth one to come around and assist with the digging operation, as this paleontologist W.D. Matthew described it in a museum guide. And when you look at the exhibition of early hominids, that theme is even more pronounced, where now early humans, these were called Cro-Magnon man in the Hall of the Age of Man, are shown cooperating with one another, not just for kind of utilitarian ends, right? Not just to procure a common food source, but rather to engage in kind of communal acts of creative expression, right? To make paintings on cave walls and things like that. So just as capitalism had grown to be more intelligent through kind of corporate consolidation and rational management from above, the claim was, so too has evolution in the natural world produced more intelligent, more cooperative organisms that can kind of manage their environment and kind of manage their surroundings for the greater good.
Great. So I want to make sure we get to questions about dinosaurs today at the end of this, but I have a couple questions from our viewers that I think relate to this. And I also want to invite Bob Peck to join us again if he has any questions about what we've discussed so far. But I want to ask, because I think it's related to what we're talking about now, this question from Elaine Ayers, who has a question about how gender plays out in this narrative and how whether or not the history of dinosaurs in the Gilded Age is an inherently masculine story. And then she also asks if there's a way to kind of connect this, or is it related to the current phenomenon of paleontology as an attractive science for boys, but not necessarily for girls? So maybe you can tackle that while Bob collects his thoughts.
Absolutely. I wonder, should I keep sharing my screen, or should we go back to the kind of more interactive way of doing things? What do you think?
It's up to you.
Well, let's see, maybe I'll share my screen for now if there's a question for which I have a slide that's obviously
good
and I can use this slide. The gender question is great. There is clearly a strong gender dimension, and the person asking the question is exactly right, that dinosaurs were almost invariably gendered male. And paleontology as a whole, I mean, I would say certainly in the 19th century, science as a whole was very much gendered male in the sense that scientists were expected to be men, and most kind of prominent members of the scientific community were men for that reason. There's a major exception here, which is one of the reasons I wanted to start with Mary Anning, is that she kind of bucks this trend a little bit. She pushes against this conventional narrative of science as having been a sort of exclusively male pursuit. And she was really celebrated. I think one of her contemporaries, I think it was William Buckland, described her as a geological lioness. So anyway, she was really celebrated as this sort of outstanding idiosyncratic figure in the history of paleontology. But yeah, you're exactly right that dinosaurs are very much gendered male in the history of paleontology. And paleontologists themselves, I think this is still the case. There's a huge gender imbalance in the paleontological community. So if you go to the Society of Herbert Paleontology meetings, for example. It's not the case. Of course, it is true that there are notable and very accomplished female paleontologists, but still it's very much a kind of male-dominated community. And there is work being done to try to sort of, again, sort of buck that trend in the sort of tradition of Mary Anning, but there's work that remains to be done. If there's time, I wonder if I could tell, Robert,
I was just going to pick up on that same theme. There was another woman who was a contemporary of Mary Anning named Etheldred Bennett, also English. She was finding invertebrate fossils and supplying them to collectors all over the world. But interestingly, she was elected to membership in a couple of scientific institutions only because people misunderstood her first name. They assumed Etheldred was a man. And so she was elected, and it was the only woman elected at that time to a number of scientific clubs.
Great. Okay, so actually, since Bob, you're on the call now, I'm going to ask a question to both of you. There are several questions here about how the story that Lucas has been telling us kind of connects to the earlier history of paleontology and also the discovery of fossilized mammals like mammoths. So there's a question from Estelle Markel-Joyer about whether or not we see late 19th century dinosaur hunters as part of Jefferson's legacy. So Jefferson in particular being very interested in proving, that the New World was better than the Old World based on the size of the dinosaurs that were located here. And just sort of generally questions about the relationship between the discovery of mammoths and dinosaurs. So I don't know, I know Bob, you've written about this some as well. If you want to start, and then we'll shift back to Lucas.
I'll start off and then we'll switch back to Lucas. Someone else I noticed had asked a question about Charles Wilson Peale and where does he fit into this story? And of course, we all know Peale had his wonderful museum at the American Philosophical Society to begin with. So it's a nice link to today's meeting. And then at Independence Hall, he had the first mounted, articulated skeleton of a mastodon, or a mammoth as he called it at the time, and it became very much a part of the vocabulary of the day, that mammoth was something huge. And he impressed his visitors and encouraged them to pay a little extra surcharge so they could see what was hiding behind the curtain in that famous self-portrait. was actually in a different room, but you get the point that he made the most, as Lucas has said, some of these museums in the 19th and 20th century tried to attract audiences by having popular subjects like dinosaurs. At the time Peale was working, there were no dinosaurs. Nobody knew about dinosaurs yet. And so he had what was the equivalent, which were early prehistoric mammals, and he could display those and did so in a way very much like Benjamin Waterhouse Hawkins.
Yeah, the connection is apt. Dinosaurs were used in the late 19th century in much the same way that Jefferson in the 18th century used the mammoth to kind of celebrate American exceptionalism, right? To kind of celebrate the exceptional power and fecundity of the United States, and especially the power and fecundity of the American wilderness. Perhaps the best example is Andrew Carnegie, who founded a museum, philanthropic museum in Pittsburgh, the city where he amassed his great fortune in the steel industry, the Carnegie Museum of Natural History. After it was founded, he had his curators, museum curators, go into the American West and discover a great big dinosaur that they could put in the main exhibition hall of this museum, something befitting the greatness of this titan of industry, this kind of great American robber baron. And they did, and they found a Diplodocus, very kind of large plant-eating dinosaur, quite similar to Brontosaurus, if you're familiar with that creature. And they named it after Carnegie, so they named it Diplodocus carnegii. Carnegie had his curators fashioned about a dozen plaster cast replicas. So very similar to the kind of thing that Hawkins did with Hadrosaurus, fashioning about a dozen plaster cast replicas of this dinosaur bearing his own name, and went on a grand tour of Europe. Carnegie was himself born in Scotland, but made his great fortune, emigrated as a child to the United States, where he made his great fortune, was a great American patriot, and loved to kind of lecture and harangue European audiences about the superiority and virtues of American style capitalism, which could produce this kind of upward mobility of which he was the best example. So he went back to Europe, went on his great tour, and deposited these plaster cast sculptures of his dinosaur bearing his name in a bunch of European museums. So you can still find them in Paris at the Museum d'Histoire Naturelle, in London, in Vienna, in Berlin, there's a copy. And often these dinosaurs were met with mixed results by European audiences, and in particular European paleontologists and kind of museum curators were often a little hesitant and you know, weren't super thrilled about the idea of kind of displaying this sort of massive, this mammoth kind of sort of testament to American greatness and American exceptionalism in their kind of, you know, august temples of European science.
Great. So there's two questions I want to make sure that we touch on before we run out of time. And to those of you, if we don't get to your questions today, I will make sure that Lucas and perhaps also Bob, if he's willing, we'll take a look and we'll get these questions answered and posted online with the recording of this video, so that, you know, we can engage with all of these really thought-provoking questions. There's one question though from Gustav Lester, which I think picks up on some themes from other questions about, you know, dinosaurs not just being a source of scientific and economic value, but also a symbol of political might. So there's a question specifically about, you know, what are the colonial or imperial contexts of the story you're telling? And perhaps we can use that to pivot to thinking about the emergence of a global economy of paleontology. So I don't know, Lucas, if you want to start with that, and then Bob, if you have thoughts, we can move to you.
Yeah, that's great. Another great question. And it's spot on. It's dinosaurs are deeply bound up with the history of American imperialism, American empire. And Adriana's right that this continues to be the case in the present day. I would say briefly that it's certainly true in the late 19th century. So I described what's sometimes called westward expansion as an act of kind of settler colonialism. I think that personally, that's the way I think about it. I think I would say that that's the right way to think about it. And Native Americans, so we, you know, often talk about the discovery of dinosaurs in the American West in the 1870s. And in some ways that's kind of, you have to sort of ask yourself, well, what do we mean dinosaurs were discovered in the American West in the 1870s? There's people who've been living in the American West for, you know, hundreds of thousands, millions of years. Surely they took an interest in these dinosaur fossils. And in fact, there's a great deal of evidence that Native American peoples have long taken an interest in dinosaur bones and other kinds of fossils that litter their ancestral homelands. The Lakota and Dakota Sioux, for example, there's all sorts of interesting evidence that prehistoric fossils play an important role in their own kind of creation narratives and origin stories, in much the same way that they play an important role in evolutionary and geological histories of the Earth. And indeed, Lakota, Sioux, and other Native Americans often served as guides to 19th century paleontologists. So Otniel Charles Marsh, for example, often worked closely, and for example, worked closely with the Lakota Red Cloud in order to locate promising dinosaur bones. And Adriana is just exactly right that that's very much still the case today. The best example of this is probably a dinosaur called Sinoceropteryx prima, as the name suggests, closely associated with China. So what this specimen illustrates is the fact that the kind of World Center for Paleontology has in many ways kind of moved from the United States, especially the American West, over the course of the 20th century has moved across the Pacific to China. And many of the most spectacular, most interesting paleontological discoveries are now made in Asia. Not only China, I should say, also Mongolia, many other parts of Asia. But in particular, there's a region in northeastern China called Liaoning Province that has been the site for the discovery of really spectacular, well-preserved dinosaur specimens, of which a particularly important example is Sinoceropteryx prima. Here's the scientific article that first described this specimen to the scientific community. Actually, that's not right. This is the, I'm sorry. Anyway, it doesn't matter too much. But the point is, one thing that's really interesting about these specimens is that the fossils that have been discovered in Liaoning Province in China are so detailed that one can often even find impressions of the feathers that these creatures bore. And so this in turn has led to a complete revolution in the way that we imagine these specimens now. And whereas in the late 19th century, they were imagined as these kind of drab, dull, kind of slow-witted creatures, now they're seen as the kind of ancestors of modern birds, right? So feathered, colorful, social, highly intelligent, very active creatures. And that's very much a kind of result of the transition of paleontology, kind of the site of paleontological fieldwork from the American West to Asia. And I can't help but think that there's a kind of coincidence here with the rise of Asia as a kind of economic powerhouse in the second half of the 20th century as well.
Bob, what do you think? Do you see these connections the way that Lucas does? And perhaps as a tag on, can you maybe talk about, as a curator at the Academy of Natural Sciences, how these ideas that Lucas has been talking about, do you see the connections between this coinciding with how things are exhibited in the educational materials that are put out by museums and kind of explaining the history of paleontology?
Yeah, very interesting. Well, I think Lucas's new book will help to change the way in which many museums do interpret their displays. I loved his analogies between the Charles Knight paintings of animals fighting it out or cooperating, all of this sort of anthropomorphic interpretation of science. Many of naturalist museums, of course, are famous for their dioramas. And those often created family groups in the 20th century with, and usually again, very male dominated. Usually there's the leading male figure and the females sort of deferentially surrounding it, young ones being protected and so on. So there's always a social story that lies just beneath the surface of how science is interpreted to the public.
Great. Well, I think we're slowly running out of time, unfortunately, but I do want to ask the final question, and I think you started getting to it, Lucas, about, you know, how does the way that we think about dinosaurs, how has that changed since the long gilded age that you talk about? I mean, they've gone from being these dullards to being these incredibly dynamic feathered creatures. I mean, how does that kind of reshape the way that we in the modern world are thinking about deep time as a source of analogy?
That is a great question. If I could just quickly show this image, just to kind of reiterate this point that the way that we imagine dinosaurs couldn't be any more different now than it was in the late 19th century. So this is just showing you a kind of more modern rendition of dinosaurs. So you see them. They're covered in feathers, they're colorful, and they're hunting in packs, right? They're cooperating with one another. So much more similar to the kind of paintings of mammals that I was showing you from the early 20th century. Deep time is such, thank you, Adriana. Deep time is such an interesting concept. And it's, when I started research on this book, I was struck, I would really say I was amazed at how recent the history of our thinking about deep time really is, or at least there's a certain way of thinking about deep time that is of quite recent origin. And that is this notion that the Earth is, the history of the Earth exists, that the Earth exists on a radically, vastly different time scale than human history. That human history is, you know, the kind of thing of living human memory, maybe kind of narrative accounts that we tell ourselves about our family's histories, right? So something that you can kind of hold in your mind, you can kind of project yourself back a few generations, maybe even a few hundred generations. But people really only started thinking about the Earth as being something that is just on a completely different order of magnitude. The age of the Earth as being, and the universe as being on a completely different order of magnitude. It's really something that's only a few hundred years old. One thing that's really interesting about the history of that concept of deep time, of a kind of radically different sort of time scale than that in which human beings lived, is that in some ways it kind of removed human beings from the history of the Earth, and therefore kind of seemed to have removed human beings from the history of geology, in fact. That human beings are seen to be sort of distinct from, that human history and geological history are seen to be sort of distinct from one another. That's something that's really changing now, and I think has to be changing, you know, with the kind of impacts that human beings are having on the ecosystem that we're in, the kind of geological kind of the scale of the human impact through the release of fossil fuels into the atmosphere, right, through the kind of release of CO2 into the atmosphere from burning fossil fuels. We're changing the Earth, not just on a kind of human scale, but really on a kind of geological scale. And so we're noticing, we're realizing that human beings are in fact very much a part of geological history, that we're not at all distinct, even though the time scale might be so almost unimaginably, unfathomably large, that we are very much a part of geological history, and we have to take that seriously, and we have to kind of accept our responsibility as geological agents.
Great. So I want to end where we began, and I'm actually going to reshare my screen, if I can.
I have to exit my screen, maybe?
I can do it.
Okay.
Maybe. Yes. Okay, I want to end where we began, in Philadelphia. So because we are doing this through the American Philosophical Society, although we are closed, I want to point to a couple places in our collections where you too can find dinosaurs at the APS, and of course at the Academy of Natural Sciences, which also has many papers and specimens related to the history of paleontology. So you can see here the Folk papers, the Simpson papers, the Bukowski papers, and of course microfilm versions from Marsh and Cope. And you can see these in our collection search. But for those of you who are at home and looking for dinosaurs now, we do have some really great materials in our digital library. So here is just some examples from the dig site that Robert Peck mentioned at the start of this talk. So you can play around. You can read these correspondence and see for yourself where they found the specimens, how they were thinking about the specimens, and you know their attitudes towards these discoveries. So I encourage you to discover dinosaurs for yourselves at home. I want to thank you all for being here. Many thanks again to Bob Peck for those wonderful introductory comments, and to Lucas for sharing his work with us, and we hope to see you all at one of our APS events soon. So thank you.
Thank you so much. It's been a real pleasure. Thanks.